Hello and welcome to Speakeasy, where we will focus on people in the public eye. Each week, my guest will be with me for the full half hour, and my guests will be those people who are considered to be leaders in their field, those who have achieved a high degree of excellence and are called the experts. And in the coming weeks, my guests will be both men and women in the fields of foreign policy, economics, music, art, the humanities, medicine, education, and big business. And in keeping with our philosophy here at Speakeasy, it is our intention to provide you with an intelligent alternative to network programming. And we hope that our programs will be of the highest quality and delivered in the most sensitive and thoughtful manner possible. And with me today is my guest, Dr. John G. Stesinger. And I need to tell you a bit about the doctor's past because it certainly more than qualifies him as a leader in the field of foreign policy. It was on the eve of World War II that John Stesinger and his family fled Nazi-occupied Austria to Prague, Czechoslovakia. But shortly after they arrived there, they witnessed Hitler rolling into that city. So they were on the move again. And as Dr. Stesinger has told me, they ran, unfortunately, in the wrong direction. They went to Russia, where they lived for a time under Stalin. And then, via the Trans-Siberian Express, wound up in Shanghai, China, where he lived for 7 years. And as a young man in China, Dr. Stesinger worked with the refugee organization. And while he worked with them, he befriended a man who later helped him to obtain a scholarship to an American college, a small college in the Midwest in Iowa called Grinnell. And after his studies at Grinnell, he went on to Harvard University in Cambridge, where he earned his doctorate degree. And after he finished at Harvard, he started teaching, and he taught in several of our country's outstanding Ivy League schools. After that, he became acting director of political affairs at the United Nations. He has taught at Hunter College, the City University of New York, for 25 years, and he is now the distinguished professor of international affairs at Trinity University in San Antonio, Texas. And if you think he hasn't been busy enough, during all of this time, he managed to write 10 leading books in the field of foreign policy. One of those books won the prestigious Bancroft Prize at Columbia University for the best book published that year in that particular field. And he tells me he is now at work on book number 11, but his first novel, and we certainly look forward to seeing that published very soon. And Dr. Stesinger is first and foremost an educator. And I, also having taught for several years on both the high school and university levels, feel that there are some ideas and some feelings I'd like to share with Dr. Stesinger, should we have time. But first, I'd like to welcome you, Dr. Stesinger. Thank you for being with us.
Thank you for this very nice introduction.
I hope that people who introduce you on the lecture circuit know that they have to put aside at least 5 minutes, and that's just for a brief introduction of your background.
One small correction, I wasn't a doctor yet, fortunately, in China.
No.
That would have made me very old.
No, he's very young. There are a few things that I would like to talk with you about today, because one of your books is a big favorite of mine, and that is Why Nations Go to War. And I would like to show this, if I may, to the camera, Why Nations Go to War. And I have a feeling that if more of our leaders in Washington would read this, we wouldn't be in the difficulty we are in now. But Dr. Stesinger, I would like to try to clear up a few things for our viewers, namely the MX confusion, the controversy, Reagan and his arms plan and his budget spending, his defense spending. I know a lot of people out there feel that it is not relevant to them and they don't pay attention because they can't make heads or tails out of what's going on. And I don't think this is true. How do you feel?
Well, are you a poker player by any chance?
I have played, but I wouldn't call myself a real player.
All right. Let me use a poker analogy by which I could explain both sides of this mess. Reagan wants to build the MX missile so that he's stronger than the Russians. Because he thinks if we are stronger than they are, they will fold their hand. That's his position. You have to lead from strength. Now, much of the country, and I suspect possibly even a majority of the country, certainly a strong minority in the Congress, doesn't feel that way. They think that if Reagan builds the MX missile and makes the United States superior to the Soviet Union in nuclear missiles, the Russians will not fold their hand, they will call it, and they will build their version of the MX missile. And it'll simply raise us up to a higher level of escalation of nuclear missiles without resolving anything, and it'll be some steps closer to the brink. Not only is that the case, but also we're spending now already $250 billion a year on defense. Over the next few years, $1 trillion. Now, a trillion has so many zeros that I lose count. You know, I call this mego dollars. Mego stands for, I suppose, my eyes glaze over, you might say. So I'm frankly against the MX missile, but I have good company. For example, the former chief of the Central Intelligence Agency, Stansfield Turner, wrote an article recently against the MX missile. Many very thoughtful people in the mainstream, not on the left, but centrist people like myself, think the MX missile is nonsense.
I believe Thomas Watson Jr., former chairman of IBM, came out with an article.
I see you have done a lot of reading.
Times of the same attitude.
Absolutely right, that Thomas Watson Jr., who was chairman of the board of IBM, and later, by the way, became ambassador to the Soviet Union, as you probably know, was also against it. So this has really become a very vigorous debate. Now there is something that most Americans don't know, I think, and that is this, that every time a new missile is built, it isn't the Russians who build it first, but we are. Did you know that, for example? For example, we built the H-bomb first, the Russians followed suit. We built the ICBM first, the Russians followed suit. We built the MIRV first, and the Russians did theirs. And I'm now convinced if we build the MX, they will build their MX, whatever they'll call it, and then we'll be up there closer to the mushroom cloud. So that's why I tend to believe that it's not only a waste of time, but a waste of money, and terribly dangerous, which does not mean, however, that I don't believe in a strong defense. But I think putting all our eggs into the nuclear basket is probably the wrong defense.
And you feel that Reagan and his advisors are unaware of this fact? Unaware of the fact that we have been always the first to build these weapons?
Well,
and that they don't expect the Russians to follow suit? Surely they must?
That's a good point. You see, I really think that Reagan believes that if we are stronger, they will simply cave in. But Reagan is not exactly a good history student. I'm not sure how much history he knows. And I don't think that he may be aware of the fact that the historical evidence suggests every time we go first, the Russians follow us. Now, the real weakness, I think, of the United States defense establishment is not in the nuclear arena. Because we can now destroy the Russians 30 times over. And the Russians can destroy us possibly 40 times over. But you can only die once, right? So maybe if we can turn them into rubble, they can make the rubble jump. But beyond that, that's it. Now the real problem that I don't think Reagan really understands, which many people in the military are concerned about, is that we are vulnerable not in the atomic area, but in the conventional area.
Yes.
Now, let's take an example. My favorite lunatic is Gaddafi of Libya. Now, Gaddafi of Libya has recently invaded Chad. He is also making trouble in adjacent countries in the Middle East. Now, just supposing he would use a little terrorism and invade a neighboring country. Now, could we use an atom bomb in that situation?
Unlikely.
Most unlikely. Give you another example. Iran after Khomeini's death, chaotic situation. Supposing the Iranians would ask the Russians to come into Iran and protect the Iranian oil fields against the Americans. Could we drop an atom bomb on that sort of situation? Again, the answer is no. The problem, therefore, is that the Russians practice a kind of aggression that the Hungarians used to call salami tactics, one slice at a time, or that I used to call death on the installment plan, against which atom bombs are totally useless. And if we now build these atom bombs again, and these missiles, such as the MX, I have the uncomfortable feeling we will stand there like a muscle-bound giant with surrounded by mosquitoes, without a fly swatter. What we need is a stronger army, a stronger navy, a stronger air force, a respectable rapid deployment force, and that's where we are weaker.
That is because, I believe, of a volunteer program, the lack of draft, you then obviously must be for the draft.
Well, I must admit I am, which doesn't make me a very popular academic, but I am.
I was just going to say that. How do they feel about that at the university?
Well, it depends which university. You know, I think in New York they generally wouldn't like that very much, but in Texas they feel rather differently. That doesn't really bother me so much, but I compare armed forces. For example, the Soviet Union now has 4 million conscripts of fairly efficient combat preparedness. Our army is 2 million volunteers. Of the combat readiness, I sometimes feel, of Private Benjamin, in case you ever saw the program, in the early phases of her career. So this is not terrific. Then you go and compare navies. The Russian Navy is also really getting into very good shape. One thing the Falklands War taught us is that our battleships and our aircraft carriers are really becoming obsolete. We found out, for example, you probably know this, that a French missile called the Exocet,
yes,
right, which cost $50,000 per missile, was able to blow up a multi-million dollar ship, the HMS Sheffield, out of the water. Since that time, by the way, the French raised the price of the Exocet to $200,000 a
very
missile. Good business, very clever.
Men.
So, we now have to reevaluate what to do with our Navy. The same thing is true of the Marine Corps, the Air Force. The bottom line is that the Russians have been able to use their proxy troops, North Koreans, North Vietnamese. We stand there with a bunch of atom bombs and we don't know what to do with them. I might say thank God to that, but we cannot meet the Russians at their intermediate level of aggression.
They never attack directly.
Excuse me?
They never attack directly.
That's right. They use proxy troops, you
yes.
see, and we don't have any proxies. So therefore, it is in that area that we need a more flexible response.
And you mentioned the rapid deployment force, and I do remember last year a mission of theirs where several men were killed.
Absolutely right.
The commander still called it a success.
Right. Which
and
is
I
absurd.
Didn't understand that.
Well, neither did I, frankly. Probably our viewers don't either, but some of the parachutes didn't open when they dropped from planes. A few people died jumping from the planes, and the guy who ran it called it a success. So the whole thing is a misnomer. It's neither rapid, nor is it deployed, nor is it a force. And that's what worries me, really. That's where the Russians are way ahead of us.
You feel that we should cut down how much and then put that remainder into conventional arms, or do you see other places for it?
Well,
and how much do we need in the way of nuclear arms after
let
all?
I would suggest that we stay where we are now and try to get the Russians to agree to a verifiable bilateral arms control treaty.
Now, I've heard this from some of my viewers when I have said verifiable. The first thing they ask is, well, how do you verify something like this?
It's a good question. I'm not a nuclear physicist, but the people whom I respect in the field tell me now, and I respect them, that it's virtually impossible to cheat. That, for example, we can tell apart through devices called black boxes and various seismographic instruments. One can distinguish an earthquake in Kamchatka, Russia, from an underground atomic explosion, an underground test. So yeah. They can't get away with cheating very easily, nor can we for that matter, nor can anybody anymore. The instruments are simply too sophisticated. So verification is a technical problem that can be surmounted.
Well, as I said, several of our viewers have asked me about that.
Yeah.
And I would just like to stop very briefly at this point, please,
right.
Dr. Stessinger,
sure.
Because if our viewers would like to address any questions or comments to Dr. Stessinger or to me, they may write to Speakeasy, and it's post office box number 2596, Rockefeller Center Station, New York 10185. And this address will again flash on the screen at the end of the program in case you missed it. I'm sorry to have to interrupt you there.
Not at all.
Now, if we can continue, I had asked you where you would put the money that you wouldn't be spending on nuclear arms, and you wouldn't just put it all in conventional weaponry.
No, you see, if you include cost overruns, which are typical for weapons, the estimates, if we go ahead with the MX and this new Star Wars type system that Mr. Reagan talked about, satellites in space, it could cost between $100 and $200 billion, you see. Now, I would like to save most of that. I would like to take maybe a quarter or a third of those funds, maybe $50 to $70 billion, and put that into strengthening our conventional arsenal, Army, Navy, Air Force, etc. And frankly, I would like to save the rest of the money and put it into our economy, which is bleeding and continues to be. The recovery is fragile, you see. No one knows just how robust it'll be. And therefore, I tend to believe that the nuclear weapons are the main culprit that may abort an economic recovery. Let me try. May I explain that for a minute?
Yes, of course.
Look, I think the key to the continuation of the economic recovery is declining interest rates. The key to interest rates declining is the budget deficit, which annually, as you probably know, is now more than $200 billion a year. Now, I'm not an economist. You have other economists on the program, but I did take Economics 101 a long time ago, and I know that interest must be paid on their deficit. So therefore, why should the people who set these interest rates lower them if they know that Uncle Sam must come back to the trough
the
once a week
borrower,
and
yes.
borrow money to pay for these new weapons? And therefore, I'm afraid if we don't bring this budget deficit down, interest rates will go back up. And therefore, the key to the budget deficit is the defense budget. And the key to the defense budget, in turn, is the nuclear component of that defense budget, which, in my judgment, is dispensable. I think we can get a better defense, a stronger defense, by keeping the atomic weapons which we have and try for a bilateral arms control treaty, nuclear treaty, and that under that umbrella build up our conventional forces and save probably more than $100 billion into the bargain.
Well, let me ask you something that makes this very relevant to our viewers. And they're out there listening to this, and they think, as the people thought that I spoke to before the show, well, what can I do about it? I can't do anything. I can't make my voice known. I'm just one person. And this is done by members of Congress and by our president, and no matter how much they see the political rallies going on in the street or the protests, it continues nevertheless. Mm-hmm. So what can they do about it?
Yeah, well, that's a very good question. Actually, they're doing a lot already. You see, I'm not one of those anti-nuke types who stands for unilateral disarmament. That's not what I'm talking about. What you find out there now on Main Street of America, New York, San Antonio, wherever you look, there are middle-class people, professional people, doctors, lawyers, business people from all walks of life who seem to have said, enough, this has to stop someplace. Responsibly, bilaterally, verifiably, but it must stop. And I think by now, to answer your question specifically, what can our viewer do? First thing, if our viewers share this position that I have now suggested, that this has to stop somewhere, that we shouldn't again go ahead and build yet another generation of nuclear missiles, the first thing such a person should do is do a little reading. You were kind enough to hold up my book. Wouldn't do any harm for them to read it, Why Nations Go to War, or any responsible article that is objective on that subject, so that person knows what an MX is, or what a missile is, which is fired from one continent, flies through space, and lands, say, in Russia, conversely in the United States.
And they should also be aware that they're counting warheads instead of missiles.
Very good. You have done a lot of reading, evidently. That's right. You see, missiles have different numbers of warheads, and therefore it might make sense, as some people have said in the Congress, when we compare our nuclear strength with that of the Russians, that we not count missiles but warheads. And interesting enough, when we count warheads, we are roughly even, roughly symmetrical, you see. So that's quite true. So the first thing a viewer must do is to make himself or herself intelligent about the subject, so they're not written off as an ignoramus. Read some books so they're knowledgeable. And then if they feel the way I do, you know, I don't know how you feel, but the way I do, is to join one of those responsible mainstream groups. To give you an example, there's a group called Doctors, Physicians for Social Responsibility. Now, these are perfectly respectable people, middle-of-the-road physicians, who have joined together and who are trying very hard to stop this insanity. And I'm one of those people, you see, who feels it has already gone virtually too far. If we go much further, we may not be here in the year 2000.
Let me ask you something else. There's very little known in this country about the Russian people themselves. Mm. The average person on the street in Moscow.
Yes.
We have a very old-fashioned picture of them, and it's quite distorted, I think. Of course, very little information is let out. But nevertheless, we see them as some sort of huge monster and terrible people and warmongers. And I know this is not so.
It isn't so.
No, they don't want war just as we don't.
Right.
Now, how can we have more of a relationship or develop an understanding with the people themselves? Not with the people of the Politburo.
Right, not with the government, but the people in the streets of Leningrad or Moscow. Sure, whenever I go there and talk about it, they're just afraid of us as we are of them. There was a recent program, I believe, not all that long ago, by Harding Carter, who interviewed Russians in the streets.
That was an excellent program, I saw.
Yes, in which he interviewed ordinary people in the streets of Russian cities.
Outstanding.
And they responded the way ordinary Americans would respond. After all, the Russians did lose 20 million people in the Second World War. They don't want to blow up either, you see. So I don't think the differences are that great, really, between our two peoples. The more Americans can travel there, the more Soviets can come here, the better it is, in my opinion. The more we get to know one another. And then there is something else, if I may say so. You hear a lot in this country about we gotta be number one. You hear a lot in Russia about they gotta be number one. It's almost like kids in a kindergarten. Now, I submit that what we have to teach our youngsters in schools and elsewhere is that sometimes it's not such a good idea to have to be number one. Sometimes a draw is a good thing.
But we don't play games in this country to a draw.
I haven't found any yet, that's right. There is always a game where somebody has to win. I'm a tennis player, for example. I can't play with my adversary and go home and say, good night, we're both terrific. We have to play a tiebreaker and there has to be sudden death. The same thing is true of football, basketball, and the same is true in Russia. Now, maybe in games that's okay, but if you transpose this into nuclear diplomacy, you court suicide.
Absolutely.
So I try to teach my students that a draw is a good thing. Not always go out to win, but sometimes allow the other guy also to be number one.
That's a very good point. And I believe that in Russia, when they play chess, they can have a stalemate.
Yeah, but then they've got to play again.
But then they play, well, this is the same philosophy that they have.
That we do.
That we do.
The stalemate doesn't count, you see, you gotta play again till somebody drops dead, so to speak.
Yes, I know.
Right. That's right.
And you think that this kind of attitude can really be changed? This seems to be something that's ingrained in our culture.
Deeply. Deeply. This is really where we get into the educational dilemmas. You see, what do we teach our youngsters in the schools?
But we're not changing the way we're teaching.
True. I'm afraid you're right. And until and unless there are changes in that direction, which I hope we can discuss some other time, then our youngsters will be taught they've got to be number one. And the Russian youngsters in this communist league there will be taught the same thing. And so long as that goes on, it'll be very difficult to have arms control treaties. Because the essence of a successful arms control treaty is precisely that, that you have a draw.
Well, in the greater scope of education, I also think that we need a greater, a deeper awareness in order to elect different kinds of officials for different reasons, put different types of men and women in our national office.
Couldn't agree with you more. Nobody reads up there anymore.
That's exactly what I was
getting
at. I
mean, both Democrats and Republicans.
I think it's been a long time since we have had a president who has not only been an avid reader, but who has also written books while in office.
Yeah.
I think JFK was the last president to write while in office.
I believe so. Well, you can go further back. You know, Harry Truman was a haberdasher.
Yes.
But Harry Truman was a voracious reader. And I can make a very good case that because of his reading of history, he made some excellent decisions, such as the European Recovery Program, the Marshall Plan. But today, who reads up there? And this is a bipartisan comment. I cannot think of...
Yes, but a sad comment.
It's a rather melancholy comment. But this is a different topic, a very related topic that has to be explored. Why is it, you see, that we don't have role models up there like Thomas Jefferson?
Well, if we had...
Who was proud of the fact that he had built a university.
If we had another half hour, we could get into that particular field of education, which I would like to do with you, if you would be so kind as to join us for another show.
I'd be delighted.
Thank you very much, Dr. John Stesinger. And this is Janice Lasser with Speakeasy.
Mm-hmm.